Hello everyone, we are today here at the German Panzer Museum in Münster, and this is the Jagdpanther, the hunting panther, which combines the long barreled 88mm gun that was also used on the Königstiger with the chassis of the Panther.
Yet the original idea for such a combination, namely an 88mm gun within a casemate or Sturmgeschütz configuration, dates back to at least 1939. At this point, the gun was still that of the Tiger I, yet over the course of the years, the design was upgraded to the longer barreled gun, which was later used in the Königstiger, although at this point, the chassis was still that of the Panzer IV. According to Jens and Doyle, the switch to the Panther chassis came in September 1942, when the first conceptual design drawings were discussed. Less than 2 weeks later, Hitler approved the design. Presented with several conceptual design drawings of a Sturmgeschütz auf Panther during a meeting with Speer on 20-22 September 1942, Hitler ordered the production of the schweren Sturmgeschütz auf Chassis Panther with the Panther engine and Panther transmission with the 8.8cm L71. Be aware that in September 1942, the mild steel prototype of the Panther was delivered for testing, yet that the first production Panther were delivered in January 1943. Now the original requirements called for an MG42, ideally with 360-degree traverse. But this museum piece and all contemporary photos I've seen so far don't have an MG42 mounted. Yet you can see this ball mount here, which is equipped with an MG34. In case you wonder why this is not an MG42, well, I made a video on this a while ago. Anyway, this ball mount was added due to the experiences from the Battle of Kursk, where the Ferdinand tank destroyers ran into some troubles. Having learned the lesson at Kursk with the Ferdinand that a machine gun was needed to engage infantry and other soft targets, an MG34 was mounted in the superstructure front to the right of the main gun in the same ball mount introduced in the Panther.
Let us look at the armament next. The Jagdpanther is equipped with the 8.8cm KVK43L71, meaning the 8.8cm Fighting Vehicle Cannon 43 L71. Now the L71 refers to the length of the barrel based on the caliber size. So 71 times the caliber size is the length of the barrel. Usually the longer the barrel, the faster the muzzle velocity. In comparison, the regular Tiger I has an L53, so quite a bit shorter. This gun was also used in the Nashorn tank destroyer, in the Königstiger, and also in the Ferdinand tank destroyer.
To give you some idea on how much this gun could penetrate, let us look at the Tiger's gun for comparison. Note that the penetration values are at 60° and with the regular armor-piercing shell. So at a range of 100m, the Tiger could penetrate around 120mm of armor, whereas the Jagdpanther could penetrate 202mm. At a range of 2000m, the Tiger could still penetrate 84mm, yet the Jagdpanther could penetrate 132mm. Or the Jagdpanther's gun had a better penetration at 2000m than the Tiger at 100. To put this in perspective, Tiger's turret armor was 100mm, whereas the gun mantlet was 120mm. As such, it could be penetrated even at the range of 2000m by a Jagdpanther. Now here you can see the gun inside the Jagdpanther. Note, earlier versions had a counterweight bolted on the side guard of the gun, whereas this gun should be balanced with a spring according to Spielberger. According to him, there were two types of barrels. So let's get outside. Do you see this step here? If you look at photos of Jagdpanthers, you might notice that some don't have it. So why does this one have a step here? Well, this barrel has two pieces. Yet until May 1944, this gun had been produced only in the one-piece variant. Although since there was quite some stock left, Jagdpanthers were produced with the one-piece gun until October 1944, according to Spielberger. The two-piece barrel significantly simplified the production process, Since working on a single piece of steel that is 6 meters long is not so easy. There were also some differences with the muzzle brake, recoil spring, and the aforementioned counterweight.
So let us look at the armor next. And some of you might immediately recognize something. This is a rather smooth surface. This is in contrast to the Jagdpanzer 4 over there, which has Simmerit applied, which is an anti-magnetic paste, so it prevents magnetic mines from sticking. Yet in September 1944, it was ordered to no longer apply Simmerit. As such, our vehicle is likely older, but we have more indicators for this as well.
First, some information on the armor itself. The front armor has 80 mm at 55 degrees. The 50 mm lower glacis plate is at 55 degrees as well. The superstructure side has 50 mm thickness at 29 degrees. And the side of the hull has 40 mm at 0 degrees. The hull and superstructure rear also have 40 mm armor and are at 30 degrees. The roof armor has 25 mm, although the first 50 Jagdpanzers only had 60 mm there. So the next time you are at the used Jagdpanzer dealership, be sure to check that out. Another interesting feature of this Jagdpanzer is the gun recess. In earlier versions it was welded. By October 1944 these were bolted, although some welded versions were also produced until November 1944. Well, I think it is time to move on, so next is mobility. Although this was a heavy tank destroyer, mobility was very important, as a report from July 1944 points out, referring to the experiences of fighting in the hedgerow-ridden Bocage in Normandy. After firing only 2 or 3 rounds, the Jagdpanzer must change position immediately. In all cases, it must drive immediately into cover, from there scout on foot for a new firing position. Because when the British spot a firing position, they react with artillery fire.
Now we are at the engine deck, and this restorated vehicle does not have the original engine. It has one of a later Bundeswehr Jagdpanzer, and the original engine was a Heil 230 P30 from Maybach. Heil stands for Hochleistung, meaning high performance. P30, the P is for Panzereinbau, tank installation. This engine was also used on the Sturmtiger, Panther, Jagdtiger, Tiger and Königstiger. It had about 600 horsepower at 2500 revolutions per minute. Now in terms of horsepower to weight ratio, the Jagdpanzer had 13.2 horsepower per ton, whereas the Panther had 13.4 horsepower per ton. Rather similar, well, same engine, same chassis, although Jagdpanzer was a bit more heavy. The Jagdpanzer reached a maximum speed of about 45 kilometers per hour, and on average speed 25 kilometers per hour on the road and 15 kilometers per hour in cross country. 15 kilometers per hour, not great, not terrible. The range was about 160 kilometers.
Similar to the regular Panther, the Jagdpanzer had major problems with the final drive. The final drive is that part which transmits the rotation power of the engine to the drive wheels. As such, it sits between the hull and the drive wheel. Hence, it's quite hard to spot unless the kitty is properly disassembled. Here you can see the setup for the Panzer III. The drive wheel is on the outside of the tank. The brake is on the inside of the tank, whereas the final drive is in between. As you can imagine, a lot of power is transmitted to this part, and the Panther's final drive problems were even more severe with the Jagdpanzer, since it was rather nose-heavy. Yet interestingly enough, Jensen Doyle note, by 28th October the final drive problem had apparently been solved when the 654th Schwere Panzerjagdabteilung reported that Jagdpanzers with strengthened final drives had driven 400 to 500 kilometers without any failures. Which of course raises the question, if the Panther's final drive was really that bad at the end of the war, as some claim. But this is something for another time. Finally, we look a bit at production. The first prototype was finished in October 1943, the second in November 1943. It was presented to Hitler in December. Already by January 1944, the first 5 Jagdpanthers of the series production were accepted by the German army. The production increased slowly mainly due to improvements of the steering units and file drives. Later on, bombing raids caused also some serious delays. As such, only 46 production series Jagdpanthers had been finished by the end of June 1944. This was a bit more than a quarter of the planned units of 160 for this time frame. It did not help that there was a lack of workers. As such, soldiers were sent into the factories. In one case, 160 men from tank destroyer replacement units were sent. Additionally, 2 more assembly plants were awarded contracts as well. In total, around 400 Jagdpanthers were produced. Spielberger notes that in total 384 Jagdpanthers were built, but Jensen Doyle lists 394 accepted by the German military forces, but with the numbers for April 1945 missing, although Jensen Doyle assumed another 21 produced before all production plants were captured.
I hope you liked this preliminary look at the Jagdpanther here at the Panzermuseum Munster, where there are way more tanks and you can get up close and personal. So a big thank you here to the Panzermuseum.
Thank you to the Tank Museum at Bovington for inviting me to Tankfest 2019. Thank you to my Patreon and subscriber supporters for helping me financing such trips. And special thanks to Andrew and Christoph for reviewing the script. As always, sources are listed in the description. Thank you for watching and see you next time.